Hello and welcome to Fatboss TV. Today we're back for more raid testing. Today we present to you Chromog Heroic in the Blackrock Foundry.
And he is the best boss. Best boss so far. Like every bridge boss in all the five mans don't even come close to this guy. He's like 60 bridge bosses altogether.
Yeah, flat out, he is my favorite boss on the beta so far. I don't think I could fault this boss. I can't really say this encounter needs to be improved here and here and here.
Apart from some bugs,
maybe bugs and maybe slight animations, but they're all temporary anyway at the moment. But the encounter itself is sound.
Yeah.
It is fucking brilliant. I'm really, really happy with this because I was a little bit disappointed with what we've seen so far.
Butcher, yeah.
But this encounter is awesome. It's just flat out awesome.
It's very, very good.
But as we do with all these preview videos that we make, let's go into the mechanics and let's actually talk about this guy.
Now, unfortunately, the boss, although he has some fucking awesome mechanics, every boss seems to have a couple boring mechanics, and really they are the tank mechanics. They're very, very dull at the beginning. The first of which is Warped Armor, which is a tank debuff that reduces your movement speed and increases the amount of physical damage you take. And of course, you need to taunt on X once one stack has dropped. It seems to be about 3 or 4, but at the moment on beta, like, sometimes the tanks wouldn't get it for a whole minute, and then they'll get, like, 3 stacks within a global cooldown.
Yeah,
it seems a bit weird. And he's like, even my pet got a stack somehow. My pet wasn't even tanking. The boss don't give a fuck. He'll just do it whenever he likes. But I assume that will actually be sorted out so you can do it properly. Very, very simple. Just taunt on X. Nice and simple.
Also, what the tanks need to worry about is an ability called Fist of Stone. This is just a cleave ability that is shared between all targets, like around the tank. So the tanks just need to make sure they're stacked up pretty much the majority of the fight just to share this damage from this ability.
Yeah, exactly. It's like 15, like he'll cast it on his main target, the tank is actually tanking, and anyone within 15 yards will share the damage as well. So of course the other tank wants to be standing on him, but you both really want to like pop some sort of active mitigation, some sort of DR as well, so you don't take the damage.
Now, a mechanic that comes in frequently is Stone Breath. This is just a nature damage breath that ticks every second, does a fair amount of damage. But it's not too much to deal with. However, this ability, if no one is stood in melee range, he'll just do it constantly until someone comes back into melee range, which actually becomes a problem with another mechanic that we'll talk about towards the end of this video.
And another thing with this mechanic is that it isn't like aimed somewhere. It will hit everyone in the encounter.
Entire raid, yeah.
Yeah, so it will just hit them regardless. So it doesn't matter which way you're facing the boss for this ability.
Another AoE ability that the boss will do is Slam. Now, instead of this doing ticking damage, it's just one fat lump of damage. And the closer you are to the boss, the more damage you'll take. So when this slam ability comes in, I suppose you're supposed to move away. We didn't really do it anyway. We were pretty much stood as far away as we possibly could, like usually max range from the boss anyway, as ranged at least. But yeah, that's all that ability will do.
And with melee, it didn't really seem like they really needed to do much in order to survive this. It didn't seem to be doing the amount of damage the dungeon journal said, at least. So it wasn't like melee were getting one hit or anything.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of hard to tell anyway because it's physical damage and of course armor mitigation comes in before the damage actually hits you. So
on live, if this ability is acting very similarly, maybe you want to use like a small DR, maybe like faint as a rogue, or to be honest, if you're a plate wearer, you'll probably be fine in melee. So we'll have to see exactly how this works, but it's really nothing to worry about. One thing to worry about though, which is the start of the cool mechanics, I'm glad we got all that boring shit out of the way, is Rippling Smash. Now what he'll do, he'll make a massive shockwave and it will go from him to the back of the room. And the actual direction it goes in changed halfway through testing. It's like they hotfixed it. We found like a little safe zone that never got hit by this Rippling Smash because it seemed to go into like 3 set locations. But it seemed to change throughout the fight. But if you are caught in this, you just take a shit ton of nature damage. So your armor ain't going to save you from this one. You're just going to take a ton of damage from this. However, it is deceptively slow. It looks like it's coming at you at like high speed because all the animations are like bwah, when really it's the crawling towards you. It's actually quite easy to move from if you are far away from the boss. So I found that like towards the end of testing, I was just standing way far back and you could literally just move from it really easily. Especially like using blinks. So, like I was a hunter anyway, so I was disengaging out of it pretty much every time. So yeah, it's quite easy to move from, but it's definitely an amazingly cool ability. And the fact that it looks like it's coming at you at like 100 miles an hour, really it's crawling at you.
It's a little bit horrifying.
Yeah, it's really fucking scary. So yeah, I think it's a really, really fucking cool mechanic.
Now also when he does Rippling Smash, he also appears to do an ability called Shattered Earth, which just does like random damage to targets. And he only ever seemed to do it with the Rippling Smash. I don't know if that's intentional, but that was the case. And of course, as you guys may have noticed, after a slam and after a rippling smash, he also does these like sonic rings that you've seen on fights like Archimedes and whatnot. They're simple little rings. Just move out of them.
Also, they can be soaked as well. So if you see a shit ton coming towards range, and maybe you're a melee who has like a high amount of damage reduction, if you want your range not to have to move in order to make it so they can continue DPSing, maybe you could soak them all. I think my pet could soak it. I'm not sure if that's intentional.
Your pet was fucking doing everything.
My pet is a nutcase, man. I didn't give two fucks. It was just doing what I wanted in this fight. But yeah, it seemed a little bit weird, but they are very, very simple to move out of. And it seems that they are random. They aren't in a set pattern or anything. They'll literally just spawn and go towards the end of the room. So at least they aren't twirling about and being annoying and everything. It's very simple. You can see the direction they're going in and just move from it.
Probably his most noticeable mechanic during this, we'll call it, well, it's not really a phase, but during this time, is Rune of the Crushing Earth. So at this point, he'll like target a player, put a red rune underneath them, and then to the left and the right of that player, two hands will appear out the ground. Now, if you're stood where these hands are, you'll actually be knocked back and you'll take a little bit of damage. It's not anything too much to worry about. And after he spawned two of these, both the hands will clap together. And if you're caught in this clap, essentially, you're going to take a shit ton of damage and be stunned for 5 seconds.
Yeah.
Now, it only appeared to happen after two of them have spawned, whereas the mechanics made out to be that if you're stood in the rune after so many seconds after it's become active, then the hands will clap down on your face.
Yeah, I think what is intended for this mechanic is that, as you said, once the rune, like after the hands are spawned, maybe after a couple of seconds, the rune becomes active, and if you stand in the rune, they will clap together. Or if both of the hands are left up for a long period of time, then they will just clap together eventually and just die to like clear space.
Which is what was happening with us anyway.
So maybe the runes aren't becoming active and maybe you can't trigger the ability. So what you can actually do, if this does continue on live, you can actually stay completely still in between these two hands, which is really scary, because at any point you could have be clapped for like 200k damage, everyone will be, but you can actually stay there until two runes are spawned and then move out of it. So it's just less, because of course you don't want to move as much, because no one can fucking cast on the move pretty much anymore anyway. So as ranged, it's nice to stay together, and it did always seem to go on rage. This never went on the tanks, this never went on the melee either, so it's always on range people.
And this is his main ability that's coming up right now, and this is my favorite part of the entire encounter. And this ability is named Rune of the Grasping Earth. Now, this works very similar to the red runes, except you want to stand in them and they're little yellow runes. If you stand in them, a hand will spawn underneath you, grip you, and keep you to the ground and will start dealing damage to you. But it's nature damage. However, while you're inside this hand, you're completely immune to all physical damage. And once you have been gripped, the boss will then very shortly after cast an ability called Thundering Blows. This will do a ginormous amount of physical damage to you if you're not inside these hands, because obviously if you're in the hands, you're essentially bopped, and you'll be thrown up into the air.
Yeah, really, really high sometimes.
And yeah, you get thrown up so high that if you don't have a blink or some way of, like, I don't know, like ice blocking or whatever, when you land, you will just flat out die from the full damage. So this is a deadly ability.
Yeah, even if you manage to somehow fucking survive the ticking physical damage, like, it seemed like deterrence wasn't doing the job, at least. It was reducing the damage, but it wasn't mitigating it. So I assume most other abilities can only mitigate it unless you, like, bubble or whatever. It seemed like the fall is enough to kill
you. The fall
as
will
is.
Flat out kill you, most likely.
And if you use an immunity, it bugs out a little bit, it seems.
If you use an immunity on this Thundering Blows ability and you're not in the hand, you just get thrown out the entire instance, more or less. As you can see what happened to me when we were testing Bop.
Oh, God. It was a bit weird.
I don't think they intend for you to immune it that way.
But either way, the idea of these two mechanics is that once the boss does start spawning these yellow runes, everyone gets in their own separate one. You can't share a hand. Otherwise, you'll just be locked out.
If two people are stood on one rune, the hand will only pick up one of you.
Yeah, exactly. And the other one will just go fucking flying up in the air.
The other one's left for dead, yeah.
So what you want to do is that you want to each find your own rune as close as you possibly can to each other as well, because you want to be killing these hands. These hands have a fair amount of health. You need to keep damaging them. If you do use big cooldowns, though, you might kill the hand too early, and then you're going to be knocked up by the Thundering Blow. So you've got to kill the hands at the exact right speed, so as soon as he finishes the Thundering Blows, everyone's out, especially the tanks, because of course he's going to start doing his Stone Breath straight away, and you need to get the tanks out so they can go melee and people aren't going to be taking a shit ton of AoE damage.
Now, one thing that we did is that we actually had one tank almost every time, just not to get gripped, but this was a warrior, so on his way back down after he's used cooldowns, I think I gave him Iron Bark most times as well, so he wasn't taking that much damage from the Thundering Blows in terms of damage. And then on his way down, he'd like charge a hand or use Heroic Leap, Bit sketchy, though.
Yeah.
But, you know, that was a really great way, because then that way the tank would always be back to the boss. He wouldn't be in a hand and everyone wouldn't have to panic to free him. But for everyone else, you pretty much need to be in one of these hands.
Another thing you need to worry about with these hands is that once the boss has completed his, like, giant AoE knock-up with the thundering blows, he will then continue to do the fight as normal. So he'll be doing his rippling smash, you know, the shockwave that's really fucking scary. And if you're inside one of these hands, you're going to be taking loads and loads of damage as it is. Yeah. And then the rippling smash is going
to
hit you.
And the rippling smash is nature damage. Yeah. You're in the hand, you're only immune to physical damage. And while you're in the hand, you take more and more nature damage anyway from the hand itself.
And it'll eventually one-shot you as well. So really, you've got to be clearing out these hands as soon as possible. AoE works really well. Like, I did a multi-shot on my own one, and it, like, hit, like, everything around me.
Seems ginormous on these hands.
I think deliberately so.
Probably.
So it's quite easy to AoE down the hand, so it is always nice if you are quite close to one another, and you can always try and, like, help other people out. Like, I found that trying to get the healers out nice and quick is a nice thing to do, and like, generally getting the DPS that aren't great at killing their own one out.
And the healers at this point should probably be damaging the hands themselves, because they haven't really got much healing to do.
Yeah, it's not a huge amount of healing. Like, especially if you've got some hots or even maybe, like, one raid cooldown going, then you don't need to worry about it at all. So it's highly recommended that you help everyone get out of their hands. And there is actually, you got to face the right way as well. I found that I was trying to damage something behind me, and you got to kind of turn your character in the hand, which was a little bit counter, like, productive in my head. I was like, what the fuck's going on? What? So you actually have to face the right way. But this is the main mechanic of the fight, and it's fucking awesome.
Yeah, and as soon as it has finished, you then do continue the fight as normal. But at 30%, the boss does go into a frenzy. This just gives him a flat attack speed and damage increase, but he'll also cast his abilities more frequently. And it didn't feel too bad, to be honest. The tanks would randomly, like, sort of get blown up occasionally. But yeah, it was, you know, just a flat damage increase, essentially.
It also seemed at this point that his rippling smash locations changed. Yeah. That could have been a hot fix. That just so happened to happen when we got to 30%. So I'm not 100% sure. Maybe his abilities will act slightly differently in the places that they go, but we weren't able to properly test this because we didn't have a hell of a lot of time on the boss. So it was quite an interesting thing when he got to 30%, though, because he did turn really red that time. He got very, very angry and started doing a ton of damage.
And there's also one more ability that is listed that wasn't on display, which is Rune of the Stone Geyser, which apparently will spawn a load of rocks that you need to destroy. I assume they'll block off areas of the room or something. This might only be a mythic only a mechanic. In the Dungeon Journal, it didn't say that it was, but this wasn't on display at all.
Yeah.
So be interesting to see how that works. But even though that they're not there, the fight is so good, man.
It is very, very good. It's very, very repetitive. Very, very repetitive, I feel.
But it's fun.
But it's very fun. Yeah. There's always something happening. You can't really, unless you find a really good safe spot, like we did it for the first, like, minute, like, first hour or so before they hotfixed it, you kind of are always moving, always having to worry about mechanics, moving from these giant hands that are spawning on the ground and then getting into giant hands that are spawning on the ground. There's a lot of things you need to think about, and generally the spectacle of the boss, it's just so good.
Yeah.
It's just such a cool-looking boss. So yeah, definitely my favorite so far.
Yeah, plus one Blizzard. So thank you very much for watching, guys. If you did enjoy this video, please do drop us a like. Helps us out a lot. And of course, we'll see you on the live stream.
Thanks for watching.
Take care.
Goodbye.